Alright, Maddie and Steve and Neil.
There's only three in the state players at the tournament.
You did alright.
Maybe under this line. So either side and then two players shaking. Shaking hand in front of Neil.
Providing the magnificent venue that they have for us. There are two semi-finals to be played today. They will be best of nine frames, so after four frames there will be a 15-minute interval, then they'll come back and complete the match. And on this table here, table one, Neil Brown. Could I ask everyone please to make sure that their mobile phone is turned off, and could I ask everyone to pay the proper respect to the game and the players and allow them to compete in a very satisfactory manner. I wish all the players an equal rub of the green, and I'll leave you in the capable hands of your referees. Thank you.
All right, coming live to you, the RACV 2018 semi-final of the National Snooker title. We've had four top seeds go through to the semi-finals. I'll be commentating on Adrian Ridley and Charlie Chafe. So, and on the other semi-final, we've got Steve Mifsud and Matthew Bolton. So great matches, four great players made it through to the semis, four Victorians and one from Perth. So good luck to all four. I hope we have some great snooker. The tables are running great. We're a little bit understaffed here in the commentary, so you're going to be hearing my voice for quite some time until Sean Budd, who's came all the way from Vegas, finds a good coffee place with Jen and brings me back a piccolo as well. So now I'll be commentating on Matthew.
Yeah, I'll put it back.
Okay. So I'll be commentating briefly now on Stephen and Maddie. Steve hit that a bit too thick, obviously, and kept the white ball down there. But it's going to take him a few shots just to get into the rhythm of the match. I expect a tight one across both semis, actually. More so against Steve and Maddie, both always have tough matches. I think the last time they played was in the semi-finals of the Ron Atkins Classic, which was a great match and went down to the wire where Matthew got up on that. So it was the final. I was going, oh, yes, it was the final, actually, yes. Now we're back to the other semi, Adrian playing Charlie. Expect a fast-paced, high-scoring match here. Both attacking players, both exciting. Previous under 21 champions, both Adrian Ridley and Charlie. Adrian is actually the defending champion who won this event last year, and he had a very, very good quarterfinal win as well. Shut Tyson Crinis out and played great snooker. A good pot. I think he's underhit that slightly, but or maybe, yep, who's next? He's going to just trickle up here behind the brown. Shouldn't cause Charlie too much troubles. I was did watch one of Charlie's games yesterday. Seemed to be queuing very well, scoring well as well. It's good to see Charlie back into the deep ends of the tournament, because he's a great player and a great queuer. Adrian's gone back to his traditional short blonde hair. You never know what you're going to get with Adrian. Is it a beard? Is it long hair? So it's, yeah, I actually think the blonde hair, no beard suits him. Otherwise, I thought he looks a little bit like a priest, but that's just me. Comes off two roughs to try to trickle up behind the reds, and he's hasn't left anything on, but he has left an easy shot for Adrian here. He should put him in trouble. Might have left a plant here, by the way, sizing this up. Oof, that was lucky to find. Should score a few here. Get his cue arm going. He's going to develop the reds, he's just going to trickle off them. Should be fine. I like the pace Adrian plays. He's always quick and attacking, always entertaining to watch, as so his opponent as well. So looking forward to this match. This is an easier shot to play with a bit of pace to give it a slight angle, but I expect him to get it. That was a great pot. Left a nice angle. He can either try to cannon those two reds and leave the red in the left corner pocket, or go into them here. Depends how he's feeling. I think he'll just try to cannon the two reds there and get on the bottom red in the left-hand pocket. That's exactly what he played. And he's opened a couple more reds here as well, so he's got another four reds before he has to do anything with the pack. Just going to land on the pink in the center. He's queuing well. Expect him to make a few here. He's definitely defending his title well, Adrian. He's going to take quite a good performance to beat him, I think, this year. Played that well, bottom left hand side to come up for the red. He's got another three reds before he has to go. That's right, George, right hand side. It's my left. George is in the background whispering in my ear. It's a voice I've had in many years whispering in my ear. An annoying sound, but nevertheless. Sometimes accurate. Tell you what, if he's landed on that, which I think he might have, is George Hoy's just joined us.
You're on, mate.
He's on. Welcome, George.
G'day, mate.
He's, don't know what he's...
Did a bit of a swerve here.
That is an amazing shot, right. I'll tell you what. It's... he's queuing well, that's... Yes, surprising he got that so easy, to be honest.
Short.
He's came a bit short. He's going to try to come up for the blue here to try to develop his last five reds. But great start for Adrian in the first frame.
Might be still a ball there. No, he's passed on that one.
It's a good effort, but it's very tough here to get into the reds. Yeah, it was always tough from that angle. It's a good 58 point lead, 67 left on the table. 63 point lead, sorry, with a blue. 67 on the table, so it's a great break, great start. He's
a great safety shot. Right on the cushion.
He was a little bit fortunate to cover that red, but yeah. Charlie's got to move that red, obviously, from the cushion. Trickle up behind it so he can't pot it. It's a great shot by...
Yes, good save.
I didn't think he can do much from that position, other than what he did.
Adrian does have a shot under the middle.
I think based on the risk he's got, he's probably going to try to kill a red and put the white up. Because if he goes for it with 63 up, probably the wiser shot to try to kill a red and play safe. But Adrian's always attacking. Tough shot.
There you go.
I guess when you're queuing like that, you can go for him. He's thinking to protect this 63 lead.
I've got to say, I watched... Adrian played Tyson Crinus in the quarter, and poor Tyson just didn't have any chance at all. Adrian was on fire. Played four frames in 52 minutes. It looks like he's carrying it on. to the semi.
Tyson did play very well throughout the event as well. Adrian did score breaks of 61, 41, 48, 54 and 61 in the match against Tyson, which was how he won in 52 minutes, which is, you expect that from Adrian because he's such a quick player, as you can see. It's going to take some beating in this event to knock out the defending champion.
Looks like he's came to play this morning. He's continued where he left off yesterday.
Yeah, this good friend of mine and one of the juniors I used to play with in Victoria, and he always had this style of play, quick attacking, fun to watch, and if he's on, he can blow anyone off the table. Great potter, good cueist. Comes from a snooker playing family. Sister's also a champion, who's won quite a few titles, who's here with his mother watching. Samantha Ridley, that is his sister who plays. What a start to the first frame. He's cueing so well. And as I said too, great to watch when he's playing well. Just everything center of the pocket too. So he's made a 60 odd. He's made two 60s in the first frame. To win if he pots this black, I'm assuming he will. 124-0, Charlie's yet to score. Obviously that's going to change, but what a great start to the defending champion. Well done, Adrian. And Charlie, I'm sure, is going to respond strongly in the second frame. Now we join the first frame, and Matthew Bolton and Steve Mifsud. Steve Mifsud currently leads 59-15 with 59 left on the table. Another great match over here. The unfortunate thing about commentating is I can't watch both of these great matches, but I'll be flicking between the two matches. This will be a tough match to call and against two tough competitors. As I stated before in their final, these two men collectively have won over 30 Australian titles between them, which is, I think you'll be hard pressed to find a great shot, Steve. Any two players in the country that have won combined 30 Australian titles. Matthew just won his 16th national billiards title, which is a huge feat. That's the respect, Steve. Avi's gonna, you won't give Matthew an inch, and it's probably a good idea.
Steve holds the championship break at the moment, 105. He made that last night in his quarterfinal match against Ben Foster. Steve played a great game.
Do you want anything?
Ben's a young, an up-and-coming player, and he's been getting to most quarterfinals, semifinals for this year. But experience he'll have in a few years.
Charlie was a good pot, bit unfortunate at the back of the red, and he's on the scoreboard in frame two. Didn't really have much options other than trickle behind the black there.
Charlie had a great match in the quarterfinal against who was it against Nye?
Charlie played, I think it was
Aaron Mahoney, wasn't it?
And I think
and
it was
Aaron was leading 3-2.
He was.
And
You want a tight, you want a tight sixth frame, just 66-55, and then made a big break in the last to win the match by 72. 72 break to win the last frame comfortably. And he beat the informed player because Aaron actually won.
Two titles.
He's won three events this year.
Three.
He's won the Queensland, he's won the Reventon Classic, and he's just come off the Albury win, where he never dropped a frame until the final. So definitely the most informed player has been Aaron Marnie for the season, for the year. And what I was saying, I've never seen, there might not have been many entries in the National this year, which was slightly disappointing, but the quality of players, the quality's going up and up. There's 12 to 15 potential winners, and that's as good as I've ever seen it. Now, given there was more entries and it's something that we're working on, the quality and the depth of play and the players coming back to Q Sports is very exciting. And as I've said on many, many occasions, this is the time to be playing snooker in Australia. And it's only going to get better and better. I know personally Reventon, myself, have got some very, very big plans for the following 2 years, which you'll start to see some even more improvements and big changes. And stay tuned for some big events. Just had a message from a very good friend of mine and also a great commentator who will be joining me today, Mark Bullen. Hey, Haiti Mark. Also, Sean Budd, Steve Ebiger. I've got quite a few players joining us in the commentary box. I'll probably get James as well up here, so you'll get some great commentary all day. And you won't have to hear my voice all day, which is always a benefit as well. I talk all day for a living, so I'm not going to be talking here for eight hours either.
This could turn into a different sort of game here if they start playing push the white at the back of the reds, because that red over the middle pocket's going to make it very difficult. No, Adrian's not going to go down that road.
So, George, this is actually your home club, and it's always a great event and one of the best venues in the country. Would you agree?
Definitely, 100%. All the players really enjoy coming to the RICV club, and they're well looked after when they come here and enjoy it.
It's something like the 18th or 19th year here. It's been a big success, a big hit as a venue, and I'm in close discussions now, and I think we're very close to pulling off having an event here every year for myself, a Reventon event, which I'm very excited to. Hopefully host this every year. Yeah, he didn't. Adrian just missed that a little bit, so it's given Charlie a chance. A tough one, but still a chance. They're just seeing if it's touching. Must be close. Yeah, it wasn't an easy shot.
No. Looks like it's landed safe, which isn't too bad for Charlie.
Gives Adrian a pretty easy shot here, just to put him in trouble. I might be able to nick it in as well, which I think he's going to go for.
Well, when you're playing this well, you can putt anything. That's a great shot.
Nothing's safe. I think when Adrian's queuing well, he's probably one of the best single wall putters we've got and long putters in the game.
Like you might take the black. No, changed his mind.
couldn't really do much, but he did screw back about 12, 14 feet there. He's landed well. He can roll this through and play the blue in the opposite center pocket.
Oh, a little bit far.
Look, the way he's queuing, I was expecting to get this run through. Yeah, he's not missing much.
No.
He's not missing much. He hasn't done much damage to hands.
Yep.
Oh, my goodness.
He's left this up for Charlie. I think he's snookered the rest of the reds. Obviously, yeah. It's a tough shot, but it could have gone behind the green, so... At least he has a shot at it, I guess. He's mishit that quite a bit, and I think he was very fortunate with the outcome. It's
going to be worse.
It's one of my shots, that one.
Okay.
He missed it by about a foot and landed safe in the middle of the pack. We could be here for a while, guys. Yeah. It looks touching from here.
Yep.
Definitely. Now we've got no idea from where we're sitting whether they're touching, but obviously Kim, who's a very good referee, would have ascertained that. That's a very clever shot.
That's a good shot from Charlie.
He's had to make sure to hide that red at the top so to avoid leaving an easy safety shot for Adrian and putting him in trouble. So it was a clever shot. Steve's just won the first frame in the match against Matthew, so Steve's just gone 1-0 up. I'll just be bringing you some updates during both matches so we know what's going on. So
Charlie's tried to create a safe shot and left a red over the hole, and it looks like Adrian's back in the game again. Oh, that's not the best shot. Played that too strong and ended up difficult.
He's tried to go behind the brown there, but mishit it a bit. But he has not too much trouble. But Charlie's got this red here. I'm pretty sure he can see that. He can come off two cushions behind the pink and leave the white in line where he's now giving a snooker. I think he's. Yep. Like that.
Oh, that's a good shot.
He had a big line. He had a big three balls there with the brown, blue, and yellow blocking there for a snooker, cutting the other side off. Obviously, the black being across the other corner pocket makes his safety shot a lot harder. So it was always the shot to play there, and it was a clever shot.
Adrian's gone for the putt. Oops. Well, here's a real opportunity now for Charlie. First real shot he's had.
I always like watching the young Victorians play because I used to play against them, and it makes me proud seeing them in later stages of the tournaments. Like now, you've got Matthew playing another table as a player that I used to compete against. You've got Adrian as well. Charlie was obviously a bit younger, but it's always good to see these players in the later stages of the event. Steve I grew up with, so it's good seeing them play well and going deep in events. That was a good pop by Charlie's. Very well cued. He's got a long backswing, Charlie. Hits right through the ball. Very laid back sort of character. It's kind of the way he approaches the game, the way he walks around the table, the way he cues. But very effective.
Both players are very quick. And Charlie, as you can see, moves around the table very fast.
It could be two of the fastest players on the circuit, actually. Charlie and Adrian. If they're not the two fastest, definitely two of the fastest players on the circuit.
It's always fun to watch. So he got a good chance here. Another three, when he pots this, there'll be another three loose threads. He can run through here, open it up. He's
under hit that.
He hasn't caught the red well. He's caught it too fat, so he's going to have to play safe here. You'll be disappointed with that.
Yeah, he had a great opportunity there to get well into the frame.
Oh, yeah, he's 9 points in front, but he would have wanted to really put a lot more points on the board there. Great pot, great cueing, center of the pocket.
In great position too.
It is. I think Charlie hasn't settled down yet. Until he wins his first frame, I think he won't have settled down. And I guess Adrian in the first frame just overtook that frame, and it's a little bit harder to settle down when your opponent's playing so well. His head a bit short, but he's done well to land there from that position. He's going to have to go up now for either the brown, blue or yellow.
He might take the blue here thinly and crack the reds.
It's very tough, I think, because if he's playing that shot, he might have to put side.
All right.
So. But look, he's potting that well. It's a possibility. I don't think he'll take it, but he's played the smart shot here. Just play behind the brown, put Charlie in trouble. So the blue was just way too risky even for Adrian, I think.
Yep. Just tried to clip that one.
Definitely a miss. He's going to have to put him back there because he doesn't really have an option. And I don't think he'll have too much trouble in hitting this. Just misjudged it slightly. But he'll definitely make the correction he needs here to be able to nip. He's trying to nestle up against them to not leave any possible pot. The danger is if you hit that single red and you don't catch it correctly, you could leave a potential pot on it, which is he's trying to avoid.
He hit that a bit firm.
Yep, and that's...
He did well.
Yep, he's landed safe, which was the main objective there. Adrian does have a big wall for the blue and the yellow here. Come off two cushions with bottom right. Leave the white heart up to snooker him. Like that. He obviously wanted to block the reds, which great shot, and he's managed to do that. Because he's got the pink on the other side as well, it makes it a very hard safety shot. And you can put your opponent into a lot of trouble by playing such a shot. The reds are far apart now, so it's a lot harder for Charlie to hit this and land safe. That's a miss, that's way short.
On the side.
Yeah, it's not going to make it. Made it easy. On a slower table, it wouldn't have made it. It's done okay though, because he could have easily left a pot on.
Could have.
25-21 to Adrian in the second frame. He's got a good white ball here. Played that a little bit short. The line was right. Just under hit it. I'm not sure if he's on the red,
yeah,
or he can see it, because it's very hard to see from this angle. But it's not an easy red anyway. But
yeah, gotta go for it.
He's gonna screw back. He's got a lot of cue power, Adrian. So it's not gonna cause him too much trouble. He cues so easy. Just screwed back. half the length of the table and not really much of an issue.
Both of these guys have great cue power.
And that you can attribute to their cueing and their long backswings, how they hit through the ball. He's left Adrian a shot to nothing here. He can play for this red and bring the white up to balk.
Looks like Charlie's turn now to have a go at the long red.
Oh, it's actually it's been a bit fortunate to go through that, but he's given Adrian a couple options here. He can play the long one, or he can play the nick and shot to nothing and safe, and come back between that line, which is, I think it's more of a percentage shot, but obviously this kid can cue very well, so he's taken the long one on. Yeah, I just thought the other one made a bit more sense, but it's a lot easier from the commentary than playing in the semi-finals, I guess. I've never made a bad shot from where I'm sitting. Nice pot.
Nice shot. Oh, well, this is Charlie's second chance now, so hopefully he can get down to it and put something together.
Position is probably the most important, because then he'll get the other two. How's the pace? He's played that well.
Lovely.
What a great shot.
Yellow.
When I saw this match yesterday on paper, when I saw the two quarter-finalist wins, I thought this is going to be a great match. I think it's more so their styles. They're so suited. He's under-hit that. Yeah. He needed it to be another 12 inches down to make it an easy shot, but he's got to use the rest now. Nice shot. Pot, nice recovery.
Nice pot.
I think he's okay. I think he's on the green. Yep. So just got to pot that and land on this red here near the pink. Slightly under hit that. Didn't want to land so close. I still think you'll be okay. Again, he's slightly under hit that because he's trying to come across for the black, but he hasn't quite settled down yet, Charlie, but I'm sure after he gets a frame on the board, that will all change. Yeah, he's missed that. And he's gone
off. Oh, dear, he's gone in off too.
So it's a very close second frame, 33 to Charlie, 31 to Adrian. He's got a couple options here. He can put the white between the yellow and the brown, play the red round, four cushions, and leave the white hard up. That's probably the first thing that I'll consider.
Or he can put them in.
Yeah, he can put him in, but I'd prefer to put him in trouble. That's the shot he's going to pick, I think. I just think it was, who knows, he'd probably go for the pot and knock it in. I think it makes the most sense to play that shot, and it's probably the one that you see the first. Yep.
That's the shot.
I think they can see the red. He's left the shot to nothing. The main thing to consider when you're playing that is always protect the object ball. That's the first goal in a shot like that. In essence, he gave Charlie a free shot at that, which is always dangerous. Great pot. And
a little bit unlucky.
A bit unlucky to land there, but he's just going to trickle up behind the black here. Needs a bit of touch.
but shouldn't be a problem for Charlie. There you go. So yeah, that's what happens when you give a good player a shot at something for free. Shot to nothing. I think he's going to hit. That's a great shot. How's his luck? He's been a bit unlucky, but he couldn't do much more than that. It's a very tough shot. Just giving him a chance here. It's not an easy one, but it's a chance. I think Charlie's going to get this. The snooker I was referring to. And there it is. He got it.
Oh, I think he's hitting it.
That's... The way he knocks them is actually sickening. He just center a pocket, screws back, makes it look effortless. For those who have played the game, would all be annoyed at Adrian the way he pots them.
Oh.
Definitely commentator's curse there, I think. Georgie, what do you think?
Yeah, I think so.
Steve's looking in control of the second frame as well. He leads 49-1 against Matthew. But Matthew's on a decent break apparently, and he's in the ball, so it's going to be a tight frame. I always say watching Matty is you got to scrape him off the table. He's Joel, Aaron and Matty, probably the three hardest match players in the country. Going back to the original table. Commentating on both simultaneously, guys, we're multitasking. It's something we do very well at Reventon. Usually doing four or five things at once, so here we go. If we had six tables, we'd do them all at once. Back to Charlie and Adrian. It looks like Charlie's gonna secure the second frame to go one all. Yep. Oh. He had never in doubt, he says. Never in doubt. One all. Charlie, well done.
Now let's come back. He is the comeback kid. He was down against Joel Younger, and he was down against Aaron Mahone, and he's come back. So it's going to be a tough match.
Now we're watching now Matthew and Steve. Steve leads in the frame 49-1. Matthew's on a break. I'm not sure exactly what he's on, but the balls are all there in a very, very good position for him to clear the table as well to go one all. It's always easy looking for commentary. You wouldn't miss here, but on the table, it's a lot harder. Matty's always efficient when he's in the balls. Doesn't let too many go. He's played that well, cued it well. Not sure what he's on, but he's been potting for quite some time. It would have to be very close in this frame. Steve leads currently by 48 points. Matty's wearing a very good logo there. He's got the Reventon logo on the vest. Something recommend all the players to be wearing. So if you haven't got one, come and see me, come and see Chris, and I'll make sure to give you one at the next event. Big shout out to my friend Les Higgins, my commentator friend in Tasmania. We'll see you in the next Ron Atkins Classic. I'll be looking forward to catching up with you and commentating a few more matches with you as well, mate.
perfect.
Can't see because Neil's standing in front of us here, but I'll tell you in a few minutes. I've seen the corner of the pocket. Does it go in? And yes, he got it. Tell you what, Matty means business, but he always does. Great shot, and he's going to clear the table. Thank you, Dan. Matt's on 36.
Oh, so I need some more.
Which means he's still 12 behind. 27 on the table. He needs up to the pink. So more or less he needs a clearance. And I really can't see Matty not clearing from here. He's a little pit bull, Matty. He was calling the pit bull of Australian snooker. He's relentless. That's how I always used to see him as a junior. Just a tough match player. We'll just finish this frame and then we'll go back to the semi. We'll watch him, Adrian and Charlie. He's underhit that slightly. But I think he's left it on the corner pocket. It's hard to see from the angle that I'm looking at. He's played it. He's played it well. It's not the easiest pink, but I expect Matty to get it. I think, does he use the rest here or can he just reach? Yeah, I think he either needs his little 6-inch extension. Yep, he does. It's just between reaching and overstretching. So, did the right thing, got the extension. This isn't an easy shot. Wasn't an easy shot, stretching, and he had the 6-inch. I still expected him to get it, but it was a tough shot. Matthew leads by 2 points now, so he only needs the pink. Just go back to the other semi and we'll keep you posted with how this frame plays out. Charlie seems to be in the balls here, he's on a break of 11. And as I said before, when he gets the first frame up and starts to get his stride, that's when you're going to really see this match heat up. Oh, he's hit, overhit a bit, but he's okay. Unexpected miss there by Charlie. He slightly did land a bit too high. Didn't expect that to be an issue though, but yeah, he's missed that black unfortunately for him, but he's left this for Adrian. Just gets down, knocks it down the rail, screws back, comes off the cushion. It's an easy game. Also does a bit of part-time acting, Adrian, another one of his passions, he tells me. Which, when he's off the game, he does a bit of that. Oh, he's just rushed that a bit.
Overstretched.
Probably why he's got so many hairdos and different looks. Probably doing different acting roles. The amount of work that Charlie got on that cue ball there was amazing. Great follow through. come off two cushions to land perfect on the blue. And as I said before, it's you can attribute that to his great cueing, and he has a long backswing, which allows him to go through the ball. They're still on the pink in the other frame. Steve just played a good safety shot.
Seven. Go inside and watch.
Both these semis are going to be close matches. They're best of nine. I'd be very, very surprised if there's a walkover, as in a one-sided semi. I mean, it is at least possible, but unlikely.
Just going to put your tip on.
He hit a little bit too thin, the pink, so he's glanced off it, which is always a possibility there.
I've got a hard shot in the middle if he wants to take it on.
So, George, I was at the VBSA meeting and I found out the other day you've been a treasurer now for how many years?
Over 20 years, anyway.
Over 20 years and 30 years part of the committee, which might be the longest standing member, is that correct?
Probably. So yes, well, I don't think anyone else would even come close to that.
Well, no one's that old, yeah?
I can tell you, I'm starting to feel for it.
Well, thank you for all the efforts you're putting into the game. Not many people can say they've put in 5, 10 years, you've put in 30, so we appreciate it for all the people that are helping our game come together.
Looks like Charlie's got his rhythm together now, eh?
And Dan as well, who does Cue Ball TV, covers a lot of major events and all of the Reventon events he's been covering. So thanks for your efforts, and he does a lot for Cue Sports in general. Just played that.
Ooh, put that a bit
left
long.
Anything on. But
fine cut in the middle.
Too risky.
Yep.
He's going to have to play safe. I don't even know. That's on from this angle. It's very hard to tell sometimes from where we're looking. That's definitely a good shot.
Good shot.
He's blocked there. I don't think you can see the one directly under the pink. You'll play the one beside that and come behind the pink off two cushions to leave the white back up. Yeah. Matthew's still looking at the shot on the other table, because Steve played a great safety shot there. He was a bit quick on that one, Adrian, but he was fortunate to leave the white where he did. Hasn't left anything easy. This is a tricky shot, hard up on the rail.
Deeper angle now.
It was tough.
Definitely on the nick in the middle now. Not running.
Yeah, Steve just potted the pink. Didn't really get on the black. He's left himself shot at the black, but not as easy as he'd like. In the second frame on the black here, Steve leads 1-0. He's potted it, but where's the white going? He's won that. So Steve leads 2-0 in the second semi. He won the second frame on the black.
stupid. Hey, buddy. Yeah, so we go back to the third frame.
Thanks, mate. Pardon? It's not my drink.
Charlie, don't go in there, mate. So we've got, they've slightly gone a little bit off in the third frame here, Adrian and Charlie.
Charlie still leads by 37-3, though. And
which look, matches go through patches in a lot of cases where you're potting everything, then you start to go a little, you start to miss a bit and then go back to potting again. So they're just going through that at the moment. They've had a few misses in this third frame, which is going to be expected. Huh? Equivalence. I do know all about that, James. That's how I play most of my matches. There's no patches, it's just all missing.
Well, I've left a straight pot for Adrian here. Bit of par, he might get on the black, but he's taking a hell of a risk.
Sean's just came all the way from Vegas to do some commentary for us. He even made a special guest appearance in the tournament. He did a Christoffi special and lost in the first round. But he won two frames, so he did well. That was a great pop by Adrian there.
He's overcooked it.
He's still got a chance, but he's overhit it. No problem. George takes out his phone, looks like a mini iPad. I've never seen a phone that big. He said his eyesight's getting worse, but he made up for it. He's got a mini iPad as a mobile phone. I don't know how he can hold it up to his face, to be honest, but anyway, he likes it.
It works.
All right, that was not a good miss by Adrian. I think Charlie's going to
sold the station here.
Secure the third frame to go 2-1 up. You can see Adrian's a little bit disappointed there in that frame. Puts his head down. It was an unexpected miss. I'll move it, sorry. I don't know where that was. I think that'll do it for the third frame.
Very low scoring game.
When he pots this black, yep, that's pretty much it. He's gone 37 up now. No, 40 plus the black. He's gone 40 up. Now that's definitely the end of the frame. Charlie is going to lead 2-1. A difference to the frame, but just knock a few more in. Probably don't even take the black on.
Are you far away? Hello, look. Are you far away?
Yep, 38 and frame. He wins a comfortable third frame, 75-12. There's a lot of missing in that frame for the boys, but as I said, it's going through patches. Currently watching the other semi-final now, where Steve leads 2-0. Yeah.
got a few exciting commentators to come and join me, hopefully, very soon. Which always makes it a little bit more entertaining if there's a few people commentating and talking on the match. George is more of a silent commentator, just got up and left. Nice shot by Stu. That's water, isn't it, Charlie? Charlie just came and got a glass of water. I was just making a bit of fun of him, making sure it's water. It is. Joining us now with George. George Petir is going to do a few frames with me now. So I apologise in advance for his commentary. George does photography for a lot of the events. So all the photos that you see on the ABSC site, well, a lot of them, and all my personal photos and company photos, George actually takes them for me. So he's a great photographer, and anyone that wants to take any either corporate photos or snooker photos, give George a call. And it's always good to support the players that support our sport.
Thanks, Chris. All that before I've even spoken a word, so thanks for the plug.
Henry Jacuti has just put the star.
And thank you, Henry, in the background, just put a new tip on my cue. I had that tip on my cue for 12 years, but I didn't play for 10, so there you go. So I hope that lasts just as long. Seems to be a bit disorientated, Adrian, after the last frame and a half.
Yeah, he seems a bit rattled. I think the fact that the lighting has been fluctuating in the snooker room at the RACV has put him off a little bit. He got off to a flying start in the first frame with a couple of 50s, but something seems to be going on with the lighting arrangement here at the club today.
I didn't know that, but something definitely changed and went off, because the first frame he was on fire. Now he seems a bit disorientated and not himself, to be honest. Like, that's unlucky, but it's also a bad shot. He shouldn't have been anywhere near the yellow.
To Charlie's credit, though, even after the first frame where Adrian came out flying, he's managed to fight back well and pinched the next two frames. So even though he's come out strong, Charlie's pegged him back and he's leading 2-1 at the moment. Seems to be gathering up some rhythm too.
For those of you listening on commentary, please send some suggestions and give us your feedback, because we can only improve by hearing your feedback. Get people to stream and watch the snooker so we can get our sport growing. very, very important that we're heading in the right direction. I can tell you, as I mentioned before, we might not have had a lot of players in this event, but the depth and quality of players, the amount of players that can now win an event, I counted around about 12 potential serious winners of this event, four of which are obviously here in the semis, and it shows that we've got depth. Now we need a variety of players and focusing on our juniors to be coming through to see where the next run of players will come through. It's something that I'll be putting a lot of focus on next year, and you'll see a lot of positive changes in the years to come, both in junior development and in snooker in general, and in Q sports in general, sorry. Off two cushions into the pack. Yep, what a
great shot. Great shot.
This kid's got some cue power. Hits through the ball well, doesn't he, George?
He does, he cues it beautifully, and that's a Neil Robertson special, that one, the blue off two cushions. Definitely hasn't been rattled by Adrian's start, young Charlie, and he's landed perfectly on the right side of the blue there to open up a few more reds.
I think it's his attitude in general, George. Just such a laid-back person, isn't he?
Yeah, he's opted for the loose red at the end of the pack here.
It's like a Mark Williams type, where he just gets on his business, doesn't say much. Nothing rattles him. He's a cool customer.
And yeah, you very rarely see too much emotion out of Charlie. Just looking at where his next red will come from. He's contemplating the red into the middle pocket.
Down the corner.
He's gone for the long red.
He's
to the bottom pocket.
Underhit it slightly, but he's killing well enough to hit this a bit of an angle, leave himself an angle on the black to get into the pack. It's close, not in though.
He's jawed that and hasn't left Adrian on much, so might see a series of safety shots here from the two guys.
He's been fortunate he never went in off there. So he's missed them both slightly, but I think he was happy with that outcome. It's actually one of my favourite venues, the RACV. It's a nice hotel, it's in the middle of the CBD, Melbourne. It's just such a great venue. Eight tables. They're great tables as well. It's such a good venue.
Adrian's played a bit of a loose shot there and given Charlie another chance. I think he was banking on the safety element of that shot, but it's come back to bite him. And we see Charlie back in with another chance. He's opting not to go for the green into the corner. Seems to be having a bit of trouble reaching the blue though. Probably rare for Charlie, he's a pretty tall lad. He's gone for the green after all. But has he landed on the red?
Yep.
Yes, he has.
Tell you what, he goes 3-1 up here. It's not a good sign for Adrian, as given the fact that he's the last three frames, is something's really seemed to have affected him.
Yeah, it's he must be wondering what's going on to come out and play so well in the first frame and still be 3-1 down.
And yeah, it's as you mentioned, to Charlie's credit, he just got on with it, did what he had to do, and then turned it round.
A little bit short on the blue. He's probably going to have to play something a little fancy for that red down near the yellow.
Just come off the cushion.
Side. No, he's going for the longer red closer to the black.
George does load most shots up his side. That's a Brunswick joke. I think he's
Charlie had pretty much played that inch perfect. Unfortunately, he didn't get that yellow straight on the face, so it's knocked him out of position, but something tells me we could see Adrian playing from tied up behind the brown here.
I'll get you lunch.
See if you like it.
I'll get you lunch.
Alright.
Decided
to add a bit more pressure and go behind the yellow. But it seems to have kept going.
It is 59 the diff with 59 on, so he's definitely got a.
Yeah, that's what we'll be seeing Adrian take this one on.
Yeah. Hope Adrian does find his way back, because it's. I'd hate to see him continue the way he's going, because he started so well.
Charlie's played that well. Yeah. I think Adrian's lost his way a bit. I think he's almost conceded to the fact that he's lost his frame, but we'll just keep on having a crack. A bit more purpose about Charlie's game this game.
Yeah, he is. Since he came back in that second, it's just his confidence has grown and he stepped it up. That's a nice putt. Great shot, Adrian.
And I think he may have come up enough. Yep. So it'd be interesting to see a black ball respot if that eventuates here.
Yeah, obviously he's got to putt the next three reds, but the yellow's obviously a challenge.
Yeah.
But getting to that point, I think, will be his number one goal. And it'll be good to see him get his cue arm going again. Just play for the centre pocket, because he's landed a bit straight. That's a short.
No.
Yes.
Yeah, he seems to be throwing the cue around at the moment. So I think he'd be almost relieved if Charlie just... puts a knife through this one and just takes the last red, or the second last red, I should say.
Well, the last as far as the frame's concerned anyway.
Yeah, Adrian will be happy to concede this one and start fresh.
We're just wondering if they're going to have a short interval. I believe that is the case after the fourth frame. It's the fourth or fifth frame usually.
Yeah, Adrian will welcome that right now. I don't think we'll see Adrian getting up to. Yep, he's conceded and
he's coming. He's coming for a small break. As I said, I hope he does find his way, because he's the defending champ and he's played very well to get here. Played awesome in the first frame, and I'd hate to see him not continue that form.
Yeah, you really want to see these two guys going for it, because they are two of the better players on the scene. So a nice attacking battle is what you expect out of those two guys.
And going back to our second semi.
Steve versus Matthew. Steve managed to finally pinch the second frame on a black after a...
And he's leading as well in the third frame, 41-1.
Yep.
And I don't know what he's on here, George, do you?
Absolutely no idea.
It's one or two black. He's on one black definitely, but maybe two blacks. So it's... And he's going to close off the frame here anyway. That I'm pretty confident about.
Yeah, well, the balls seem to be pretty open and, you know, just right for the picking for Steve. So there's something about Steve this week. He seems very focused and determined to etch his name onto the trophy again.
Well,
so I think at the very least we'll see him win this frame.
One thing we said before when Matty was playing Steve in the final of the Ronak, and Steve went up early on too, 3-1 I believe, and you can't wait. Matty just turned it around as well, so Steve will remember that because he knows what a tough competitor he is.
Yeah,
so
Tassie won't be the best memory for Steve.
It won't be, but he knows that it's never over when you're playing Matt, and he's definitely got a good rhythm here. You can never count Matty off a match.
I don't know what it is with these billiards players, but the top draw billiards players, they're the ones that you don't really want chasing you because they can put the white ball on a dime when it comes to a safety battle.
He's on 25 with, and he's 40 in front, so 65 points in front, 15 on the table. So basically Matty needs snookers. When he pots this, 72, so you won't see Matty coming back.
Opting for the thin slice into the middle pocket, which he's missed. So Matthew will try and evaluate if he can get enough blacks with all these reds to make it competitive, but he's gonna have a go anyway.
Nice pot, Matty.
Nice red and brilliantly controlled white ball there.
Steve's actually won seven nationals. He's trying to match Max Williams' record of 8. He's also won obviously 6 opens as well, so it's something that I know he's definitely aspiring to get to reach the same number of national titles as the great Max Williams, and I'm sure that's a feat that he's going to achieve one day if it's not this year. I think Matty's just trying to get his cue on going a little bit here. I think Matt's just getting his cue on going here. And can he turn it back round from 3-0 down? As I said, he's done it before, but it's a position you don't want to be up against someone like Steve anyway.
Having said that, 72 points when you're 59 for someone like Matty isn't a huge ask. And you can see he's contemplating it here because clearly he wasn't going to get to the black or a high scoring colour off that, but hasn't worked out the best for him. So we'll see where Steve's going to put this last red.
What you got to admire about Matty, he'll never give you an inch. Doesn't matter how much he's got to fight, he'll come back.
Yeah.
He's relentless.
And this is a tough shot for Matty all round. Can't get enough of the red. He's got bridging over the brown, so
he's in all sorts of bother, but
I think his dad is riding this shot more than Matty in the background there. His dad, Neil, who actually Matty did eliminate from this tournament. So that's a little bit of family loyalty for you, Chris.
I saw that in the draw. I actually found that pretty comical that they were playing each other. I guess it's a good and a bad thing. One of them's through, one of them's out.
I did have a quick chat with Neil, and he said, "Oh, look, I think for the sake of Matthew's reputation, I'll let him get this one."
Yeah, it's a bittersweet thing because you know the one Bolton through, but one has to go out. So, but playing each other, I can't even imagine what it'd be like playing my father in an event. I think it would be awesome.
So I think Matthew's evaluating whether he can get through that barrage of colours to get to the black after this red.
I think he's going to try to leave a snooker, leave a free ball. and leave the red behind the
I think it's
he's I think this is done with
ask.
The frame.
It's a big ask.
We
something tells me he wasn't trying to hit the jaw there. And Steve will just put the baby to sleep, as they say.
Yeah. It's yeah, that's 3-0 to Steve. In the second semi. And Charlie leads Adrian Ridley, the defending champion, 3-1 in the semi final number one.
Okay, so
Matthew concedes. The amount of battles these two have had over the years is I can't even count, but okay, we're just it's currently a Reventon ad playing, so great company, get behind it.
Yeah, haven't heard the greatest things about the CEO of this company, Chris. Could you shed some light on the guy?
I think he loves snooker. There he is. He's a good-looking fella.
God, look at that, eh? That's what's commentating on your semi-finals right now.
That's right.
Boys and girls.
He's definitely got a face for radio.
Where someone is always there to support your financial and investment needs.
At Revenue, actually, you know this company well, don't you, George, in many levels?
No, I do, and in all seriousness, I have had some dealings integrity with the people at Reventon, and so far I can say that everything's been an absolute pleasure, and all the staff there are friendly and professional, and yeah, they don't leave any stone unturned. Basically, every base is covered to make sure that you leave their offices very confident, very comfortable with any decisions you've made.
We'll be running a lot of free information events for all of the snooker players around the country. You're all welcome to attend. Let's talk about which they'll be online on the websites too. I welcome you all to come on board. There's a lot of tips on how to save money, how to invest, how to pay off your mortgage, just good things to know in general, and they're all free of charge.
Okay. He does draw the line, however, at the snooker coaching, so
yes,
yeah, if you are heading to Reventon for that, then
I will be referring you on.
Yes. But I think we should be getting close to seeing Adrian and Charlie return to their table. Adrian trying to minimise the damage here as Charlie starts to get away from him.
The only thing from watching the event, I've got to be surprised there was one century made.
Yep.
With the calibre of players that have entered this event, I would have expected 5+, but obviously it's not over yet. Because the tables are running really well. The tables are running great.
With guys like Adrian and Charlie there, it wouldn't surprise me if in the second session we see one. I mean, it's probably preempting it a little bit, but it would be a major surprise by either of those two guys. And then again, having said that, on the other table you've got Steve and Matt, who's well and truly capable of knocking in another one. Their break as we see the return of Charlie and Adrian. Steve will be feeling good with the way the match is progressing at the moment.
So for those of you watching, thank you very much for joining us. Please pass on the link as well. We want to increase that number and raise as much awareness as possible of our great sport across all Q sports, that is. And we see the number increasing all the time. So, yeah, please share it on and pass on the link and support the sport. For those local players watching, head down to the RACV and support these great players. It always makes it a much greater event when the atmosphere is elevated and there's a lot more people in the room. We join back to the semi, George, as you can see Charlie and Adrian coming back. Hopefully
Adrian's been able to shake it off.
That's been a great shot.
That's a perfect length by Adrian. Leaves Charlie a tempter. Probably hit straight back into... Oh, no.
He's played a containing safe. That's, I don't know what he's... He's mishit that. I think that's on that, behind the black.
Oh, I think that's definitely on. I think he was trying to put that up above the black, but it hasn't come off for him. And Adrian looks like he's got the first chance of the frame.
I think this is very, very important frame, this one, because if Adrian gets his arm back in, it's going to obviously cause a lot of trouble.
It's 3-2 as opposed to 4-1, so...
It's a massive frame in the context of the match.
Yeah, it does stuff to a player's head.
I think what you said, George, it was that interval couldn't have came at a better time.
Yeah, Adrian really needed that break. He was showing signs of being frustrated. So, hopefully we see the Adrian that we've grown to become used to now with big pots and...
Yeah, he's hit that well.
And great positional shots and break building, so...
He's going to play here off two cushions and land on the red in the opposite pocket. That was one, sorry. I thought it was straighter than what it appeared, but he's under hit that.
Yeah, I think if he follows through, might get that last red on the pack, but should still see him through on the... Oh, no, it's a lot straighter than what we thought it was.
It's a lot harder to judge some of these shots when you're watching from... Where we're looking at, the angle is a lot harder to judge. He will screw into the pack.
Here's the shot for Adrian. Hop, hop, hop.
Ooh, he's he went for both pockets. The attention all pockets, but
so it's probably twice as bad that he's missed it in both. Although I'm pretty sure that Charlie would be pretty relieved that it didn't go into the second pocket. So, golden opportunity now for Charlie to build on his lead. Good angle on the blue to get into the pack. He just needs to avoid that pink. You don't want to be hitting that pink when you're...
He's avoided all of them.
Oh, there you go. You don't want to go with that pink when it's a good 6 inches above the pack.
The challenge with that shot was because obviously the red and the pink were so far from the pack, it makes it so much harder to judge. So he's opted to not play that shot. And he had a couple loose reds.
Yeah, looks like he's landed a little straight on this blue, but again, he has the pink as an option here. Doesn't seem to be on its spot, so he might be playing for the red that's closest to it. And he has. So it should be interesting to see where Kim puts this pink ball. And whether the red is... Yeah, the red's still a viable option there. Dare say he'll be going up for the blue.
It was disappointing to not see Peter McCulloch here this year from WA. He was a great addition last year to the event. He made three centuries on the bounce. And he equaled the highest break ever in this national championship at 143. So if you're watching, g'day, and hopefully we'll see you next year. He's a great player from WA. Peter, and you, I think you'll be coming to the next Reventon event, I hope. The actual funny thing is about the highest break, which was made twice, I remember Paul Bunn also made a 1-4-3. So both the highest break of this event, 1-4-3, were made by two WA players. I was in the room, it was the old RACV club where Paul made that.
So, Charlie's continuing on his merry way. He's seeming to find reds everywhere. So, they seem to be a little bit more open now. Charlie will be grateful that he's got that emergency black ball over the corner pocket, which he'll be using on this particular red.
Now these are a little bit tricky because they're easier to catch the draw. I mean, obviously expecting to get it.
He's landed perfect on that ridge, just at the base of the pack.
And they're in a good position here to secure a 4-1 lead. Definitely queuing well, Charlie. He's after frame one, he's really found his stride. He's walking around confidently. He's queuing the ball well.
Definitely found another gear, isn't he?
The match just turned after the first frame, and it was good for Charlie, not so good for Adrian, but it is what it is, yeah.
Yeah, huge credit to Charlie. Most players would have seen that first frame and Adrian firing along and thought they were in for a bit of a day, but Charlie's just brushed it off his shoulders and said, let's get it on after the first frame.
Yeah,
and it seems like he's got the white ball on a string at the moment. I think any gambling man would say that this is Charlie's frame.
I don't know if that was a punt at me, George, but I've stopped gambling.
No, not this time.
Yeah, as I said, I hope to see Adrian find his feet again. After that first frame, I wouldn't want to see him defending his title that way. Yeah.
Well, that was a bit of a Freudian slip there with Charlie clipping into the yellow after the blue. Yeah. Charlie was actually online to have a crack at the highest break, but that last positional shot basically ended all hope there.
That's important. Adrian does knock a few in here, and I hope he does to get the match back on track.
No. Yeah, Adrian's looking very loose at the moment. I think he'd rather be somewhere else, to be honest, right now. And Charlie's just going to lap that up. It's not too many times you get playing the way he's playing and feeling the way he is, so I think Charlie will be getting himself all over this.
It's 41 in front here on the black. He's got his three reds to go, so he needs one more red and one more colour to secure this frame, and I can say that's looking like a certainty from this point. Oh, he's gone 48 up here.
Yeah, he's made light work of this frame, Charlie, so I think he'll be feeling more and more confident with every pot that he makes at the moment.
Where is he? Where'd he go?
He's in the toilet.
So, yeah, Adrian not even bothering to get out of his chair. Looking a little bit despondent after that display by Charlie.
Cut. Jimmy says cut it. Cut it.
With that frame, Charlie's just basically edging towards the finish line, whereas you'd kind of hope that Adrian can regroup a little bit and make a fight of it.
To all you Seinfeld buffs out there, Jimmy says cut it. Cut it. That's for Kelleher, Carenza, Robinson.
I know McCarthy.
A big Seinfeld, McCarthy, definitely. Who else is a big Seinfeld buff?
McCarthy needs to spend a little bit less time on Facebook sharing Facebook videos. Sharing Seinfeld videos.
Yep, so to all you Seinfeld buffs out there, that's for you guys. Director of Referees Larry's just walked out. Doing a great job.
And what a swagger he's displaying too.
So it's like very Al Pacino-esque as we are, one will say.
Hooah!
Hooah! That's right.
Okay, so Kim putting the last pink into position as Charlie and Adrian get ready for the start of their sixth frame. It's now or never for Adrian. He's got to start attacking and with a bit more confidence. Probably easier said than done given the scoreline, but it's the one thing about these two guys, they're steeped with self-confidence in their ability.
Yeah, but
and you very rarely see a backwards step, so it should be interesting from this point on. Charlie deciding to attempt that same safety shot again. Different result, and Adrian was sitting there waiting for that white ball to hit the bag, but it didn't.
Just obviously got a nice comment from Ron Cole. He's enjoying the commentary, so thanks, Ron. Yeah, so please SMS or write in with any feedback. We've now increased our viewers substantially. I hope there's a lot more for the final. So
and there you go, Chris. There's a typical Adrian reply. Just the monster length of the table pot to get himself in. I think now he's just going to throw caution to the wind. He's three frames behind and back against the wall, so nothing to lose from this point on.
Yeah, I will say shout out to Ron Coley. He did step down last year as the VBSA president. He did serve for 17 years, so another long-standing member. 18 years, George was saying. I think it was 17, but somewhere in that vicinity. So, yeah, thanks for the efforts. Now the job's that taken now by Paul Cosgrove, who's assisting us as the president. And back to the game. Adrian seems to be potting a few, which is good to see.
All right, Adrian's hoping to get on the right side of the blue here to maybe dislodge a few balls.
I think the main one he wants to get rid of is the one to the left side of the black, so he can open the black up in both pockets. Which
it'll help if Kim has to put this pink somewhere other than its own spot, but it looks like it will sit on its spot.
Or roll on its spot in this case. Yep. So he's got the right angle here. He's got a perfect angle, which gives him options to go into the pack or to come between the gap and try to move that red. Yep. He's under hit it. Look, he's obviously wanted to open the black up in both spots. I don't blame him there because it's so tricky having that red there, but just under hit that slightly. Unless he was trying to trickle into the pack and leave it on this red, I'm not sure exactly his intention.
Still, he's
just frustrated.
He's just thrown the cue at that long red. It's not really achieved anything. It wasn't a safety shot, that's for sure. Albeit not the easiest pot for Charlie to take on if he decides to. Ooh, and Charlie has managed to take all three spots. All three balls off the spots there.
Which isn't easy to do.
No. And let's see what he does this time around. He's got no reds available on this side.
He's going to go off the same red. He needs to clear that red.
I think this time he's played it perfectly, though.
He has, and then after this, obviously, opening the black up in both pockets makes a big difference.
He's left himself a pretty straight angle there. I don't see him moving too many reds. I thought he would have just trickled that one along and left the angle on the black to hit that that closest red into the pack. A lot of work to do now, and the shot hasn't come off.
It's sometimes angles are a lot harder to judge from where we're sitting, but it seems like the shot from here.
but
I think again, he's exploring the option of a plant here.
Good shot.
Yep.
Just quick, got down, hit it.
Yeah, well, that's what we're used to with Adrian. It more often than not gets the result, and that is
a great shot.
Absolutely plum.
He has played that so well.
And he's opened up about six reds there.
He made it look so easy, and this is where Adrian wins this frame, I believe, and pushes us into a seventh. Charlie's going to want to close this match off as quick as possible and not get Adrian back to the way he was queuing in the first frame, I'd say.
Yeah, it's the last thing you want, Adrian Ridley chasing you. And chasing you with his tail up too.
Tell you what, he's actually on track to beat the highest break of 105. He goes 38, and what's he got left here? 67, 70, 83. He's got a 118 on.
I think if Adrian maintains a little bit of this rhythm and doesn't give his head too much time to think, he'll definitely turn something around here. He's played a nice shot for the pink. And it's come to an end.
1-2-1, I believe he was on, sorry.
So,
but anyway,
Charlie's got to take full advantage of this and see if he can put this to sleep.
He's got a lot to do here. But yeah, he's got 75 up on the table, and he's 58 down. I love the reaction the ball gets when he hits through it, Charlie. It just takes off. He's followed, as you can see, look how far he follows the back and through the ball.
Yeah, definitely a little bit of cue power between these two boys.
Just he wasn't what he played, but it's perfect.
Yeah, it was a bit hard to get wrong on position there with the balls being so open.
I tell you what, this is
unfortunately, he's got to thank Adrian for that.
It's got to come down to, it's going to come down to the yellow here.
Yeah.
Assuming he pots the next three reds, which I feel that he might, the way he's queuing. If he pots them with blacks, he'll be 10 down with 27 on the table.
Yeah, it's only that red on the left-hand side that you can see that might prove the trickiest out of what's left.
He hasn't hit that the best. This is actually tricky. He's got the black hampering him as well. Potted in the middle, land on the pink in the center, which means he will get on that difficult red. But it's missable.
How's that nap gone?
Yep. The angle is a lot acuter.
He's landed in the middle of five colors. I think the pink is out of commission. It's probably definitely not the ball to take in anyway.
It's a lot harder to judge from here because I thought the angle was a lot more acute in that last shot, or he could have landed better on there.
You know that Charlie wants to attack, so he won't be taking the snooker behind the pink from the yellow. And he's probably thinking he should have now. These are the shots that Adrian absolutely loves.
25 the difference. He just needs, red and a colour to leave meeting snookers, and not an issue.
There you go. But although his white ball's a little bit loose.
The pot.
I mean,
now, there's a couple shots here. I think you're killing a colour. Oh, he's going the pink.
I don't think he'd be killing the colours with 26 up.
No, I was staying plain safe and moving the black, but I didn't even look at the pink, to be honest.
But again, another loose shot, which I don't know if Adrian can expect too many different results than Charlie winning this frame if he keeps that up. And that is a little bit wayward by Charlie. I don't think they've had a frame in the match so far with this many exchanges. I think this has got to be the last chance that Adrian gets. Yeah, good angle on the green.
Let's run this through. And the balls couldn't be in a better position, I guess. Pink to black, maybe, but they're in a very good position for the team to clear up. Good putt on the green there. He played that very casually.
Yeah, the long blue. I reckon he went straight up to. Oh, almost screwed it off. But this is the shot you
he's
need.
He's just feathering. I don't know what's. Honestly, I don't even. Yeah, he's.
Doesn't seem to be there, does he?
He's just got one feather putt. There you go. He's 4-2. Mm. Seventh frame to come. Charlie leads 4-2. Now going back to the other semi-final, we're in the fourth frame. Matthew Bolton leads 17-0, and Steve Mifsud leads 3-0, best of 9.
Yep, Steve's at the table, and looks to have a good angle to do anything he wants to with this white. Looks like he'll be going into the pack. Oh. Haven't called it correctly once today, so might stop predicting guys opening packs off the blue.
You've got a.
Yeah, definitely still a lot of work to do here for Steve. So, Charlie and Adrian have kicked off in the seventh frame. And yes, there's definitely some action still worth seeing here if you get down to the RACV today. Regardless of the results for both semis, you're still going to get a brilliant quality match in the final. Looks like the balls are spread out pretty early in this frame, so we will see a little bit of safety before seeing some sizable breaks by one of these two guys. So Adrian gets first dibs to the table.
All right, so I'm back. Special guest requests.
Yes.
Took a bit of a break. They go, where did Christophe go? He's back. Don't
Some
worry,
people
guys.
Call it a break. Other people call it being a social butterfly, Chris.
That's true. I just had to thank you for some more feedback. Great commentary, Chris. Thank you. Good friend of mine from Sydney. Shout out to Mr. Kennedy. Where are you in this event, buddy? It's never the same without you. Mr. Cole, thanks for watching, along with all the other viewers.
Yeah, definitely would have been a sight to see Mr. Kennedy at this event. He seems to be making a bit of a comeback.
And he's playing very well as well. He went to, I believe, the quarters in...
In Sydney, yeah. He played some nice snooker in Sydney as well.
And he's always a good character, mate. I've known him since the junior days, and he's always fun to be around and entertaining.
Quite the writer, I hear, too. He's written a memoir.
Yeah. Yeah, he is. Oh, look at this. Oh, mate, it even landed an angle as well.
Yeah, he'd be a little bit disappointed that the black's out of commission, so he's going to have to keep heading down south for colours.
Adrian's woken up again. He's having said that he underhit that, but look, good to see him potting again and queuing through the ball, and that's good. Mm. We wanted to see a competitive match across both semis. And currently Steve seems to be running away with the other semi, but as I said, it's never over until Matty's shaking your hand. And it's good to see Sean Budd back in Australia playing in these events again. He's a multiple time Australian champion as well and won this event on quite a few occasions. It's good to see him back.
Yeah, you can always tell when he's entered the room with that famous laugh. It's pretty unmistakable.
Or infamous. Hey, actually, I remember watching him. He won 3 in a row Australian titles, which Australian national titles, which you'd find hard-pressed anyone to do. I don't know many people. Steve's done that.
And not against the shabby opposition either. I think most of those were against Steve.
Steve and Joel were in the finals, but then Steve had a run of an amazing... I think Quinton once said we should call this the Mifsud Cup. He beat Quinton, well, Joel, Bud.
Joel's, Charlie's just had a great result there. He's played safety behind the yellow, got the jaw and landed fat behind the brown and blue. Covering most of the pack.
So Ron Atkins also won it 3 times in a row. So I believe they're the only ones. Steve Mifsud. Sean Budd, Ron Atkins and Max Williams have ever won this 3 in a row, so what an achievement to be associated with those names.
A small cluster of reds starting to gather up on that right hand side. Nothing really obvious there, so it'll be interesting to see who gets the first cherry. Having said that, it's Charlie, but the white ball has gone astray, so we might see him take the pink to the middle, or we might see him take the safety option. I think from 4-2 up, he doesn't want to let too many chances drift towards Adrian here.
Now, I've got some exciting news we're going to have in the final. We're going to have some commentary as well by Steve Ebiger, Sean Budd, maybe James as well. So there's going to be a bit of a mixture and a lot of great players coming in, getting involved and helping us. So thanks for that. Just so we can mix that up and you can hear our different opinions of different players. And hopefully it makes it, you know, more entertaining having a variety of people commentating as well.
So Charlie's missed the pink to the middle and given Adrian a look in. Be interesting to see what he does with this plant and if he can go on from there.
He'll definitely take it on, that's the one thing, you know.
Yeah, definitely not going to see Adrian playing safety from here.
Well, he's...
It's not come off, and
We have a bleeder.
Charlie is back at the table. Can he close it out?
He needs a lot to do from here, being 27 down. I can see this one going to the last frame.
It's a big call.
It is, but
Look at that.
That's he was probably going to land on one, but to land there and push that red out is a bit of fortune there. But
and this should allow Charlie to put the black back on the spot.
Two of Victoria's best going head to head here. This is a very tough shot into playing into a blind pocket, and he's missable. So this is a big shot here. He pots this.
You got to think the way he's playing at the moment, he should pot this.
Good shot. Definitely a missable shot. But I do agree with you, George. You was odds on to pot it, but you have seen easier shots than that missed to close off a match or potentially close off a match to reach the final of the national title.
I was actually going to say, it is, when you consider the circumstances, these guys are playing for a shot at the final in the national, but you'd never know with Charlie. You'd think he was on the practice table on a Saturday.
An event which most players, if not all players, regard as one of the most prestigious, and has been going since 1953. So it has a very, very long history associated with it, and prestige. To call yourself the Australian National Snooker Champion would be every snooker player's dream, I'd say, in Australia.
Still plodding along well. He's only got the one red that's out of commission at the moment. He'll basically take the lead here with this pink, so it should be interesting to see. Oh, sorry, I thought it was 28 to 33 the other way, sorry.
But he will need that red, as you said, George. It's going to be...
He might use this red to move it now, actually, depending on the angle.
I don't know if he's got the angle from here.
No, it's very hard doesn't to look like he's going
it. Doesn't look like he does. He's overhit that slightly.
Looks like a long blue. And if you know these guys, they don't trickle blues in. Yep. Now Charlie's gonna really wish that that red over the bag is on past the green, because he's landed nowhere on that red on the left. But I think he's got a shot there. Oh no.
I think it's covering it.
I think he's playing behind the black here.
He's cutting this in, George.
Oof.
It's playing. Yeah. Yep.
Oh, that's just plumb, that is.
Very good shot.
As you said before, the angles are pretty hard to judge from this perspective, Chris. That looked a lot thinner than what Charlie made it look.
Yeah, I noticed that the first time I commentated when I was in the final. There was a few shots that I saw much different, but looking at the angles there, they're very deceiving when you're looking at it from the screen and down behind the cue.
Okay, so anywhere off the line of the blue spot, and Charlie's in action still.
So he's gone 24 points up now, 43 left on the table. The red on the cushion is going to be where...
he still needs it, regardless of colour.
It's actually played that well to land there.
Now, will he keep attacking, or will he make Adrian get the red off the cushion for him? Looks like he's going to go for a pot.
I think play the 4 points is good there, but unless you're in a snooker, but he's always going to go for the pot in that case, I think. Now decision time.
So now he's 29 points up. You're either going to go for glory and get 30 points up with 27 on the table,
I think he's not going to go for this.
No, I don't know. He seems to have that look about him. Oh, why would you play safe when you can pot like that?
That's a massive pot.
So that's
wow.
Giving him some serious breathing room now.
Yeah, he's just got to kill a colour and play safe, try to snooker him.
Yeah, I think he'll be...
That's hit the rail and come behind the black. Because he's got a big line here behind the three colours. And that was the shot. I actually think he can hit the green.
Mm.
I mean, I'm pretty sure he can. No? I thought he could go between that. Obviously, he's on the yellow.
That's the wrong switch on, Chris. Switch on.
I was looking at the other table, the other score as well. But he could hit the green, couldn't he?
He could definitely hit the green.
Well, that's what
I was
saying.
Pretty sure that was counterproductive, Chris, but, you know.
I never said he was on the green, but he could definitely hit the green.
I think Chris has been watching a little bit, or listening to a little bit too much of Roy in HG.
I don't know what that is, but all right, we'll take it.
So Adrian finds himself in a spot of bother now. But
hit it twice just to make sure.
I think he's just left the yellow over the bag, and I think... it won't be long till we see the shaking of hands between these two.
If this is the end for Adrian's defence, you should be proud, mate. You did a gallant effort defending your title, made the semis, played great snooker, and you're a great player, so well done on your efforts. Last year winning the event, and this year defending your title, so should be proud, mate.
Yeah, and Charlie's laid him in a snooker that's going to prove pretty tricky.
Yeah,
he's potted. Well, that's probably the best pink he's potted for a while, and there you have it, guys. His
match is over. Well done, Charlie, making the final. Great effort. And Adrian, I know you might be disappointed now, but valiant effort, mate, onto the defending champion, making the semis and playing some great snooker. And looking forward to seeing you in the next event, mate. Unlucky this time, but chin up, mate. You're still a great player and a great champion. Oh, I never heard you. We'll just re-intervene on the second semi-final, where Steve is leading
3-0. Looks like Matthew has made some leeway here, and he's bridged the gap a little, but we see Steve at the table. As yet, we can't tell what the break is, but we'll soon see after this shot, I'm assuming, because something tells me Steve won't be potting this red.
Our numbers have increased again for the people watching, so thank you. Thanks, Sujo. It's people that are joining us. Thank you, Warren, Tony Massey, Scotty Matthews, Bradley, and for all your comments as well. As I said, great time to be playing snooker currently in Australia, and probably the most exciting time, I can say.
Yeah,
of course.
You'd have to ask the guys in there. I don't know. You can finish this, yeah. So Matthew's played a solid safety shot there, but again, you see that Steve has a few avenues open to him in regards to safety. And that's a fortunate result for Steve, as you can probably tell by Matthew's response. He's got a kiss on the yellow that's put him right behind the green and blue. Probably not what Matthew would like at this time of the match.
Mm-hmm.
And I think Matthew has hit that as sweet as he possibly could. And he's also had a good result too. Now there's a double kiss that Steve really didn't want. He's given Matthew a very good chance on a red that looks like it's almost on the black spot. So a shot that Matthew's more than familiar with. I think it'd be pink or black. Oh no, he hasn't. He's missed it and he's left it on. And even from this angle, the red doesn't look more than a couple of inches away from that pocket. So I think we will see Steve pipping away another frame and one step closer to meeting Charlie in the final. And that's 28 with 27 on the table and fat on the pink. Yellow over the corner pocket. So you've got the brown on the middle of the cushion, which I don't think will faze Steve at all. He's well and truly beyond safe now, so I think we see Steve at 4-0 and another mountain to climb by Matthew. Now, as we've said before, it has happened. But I think once you've bitten the dog, he tends to fight back. So I don't think Steve will want to be reliving a 5-4 loss from 4-0 down, 4-0 up, sorry. Having said that, with a brilliant snooker like that, you know that Matthew's not going to go away quickly. And here's a shot you don't see too often these days, but Steve's played the Massey to try and hit the brown, but it hasn't come off, and Matthew will be a little disappointed that he needs snookers, because there's no way the referee's going to put that back. I dare say we would have seen Steve playing to get that brown for quite a while had he been in the game. So I think the term is he's done himself a mischief here. He's potted the brown and snookered himself on the blue. Might have a thin edge here, but like we established before, it's a little bit hard to tell from this angle, but no. And it seems like double kisses everywhere at the moment. But that could have landed a lot worse. 31 points down on the blue. I dare say, unless you see something absolutely drastic on Steve's part, we'll see Matthew conceding soon. That's a good shot from Steve. Not leaving Matthew much at all. He'll probably just play the thin slice and put the blue on the top rail, escaping between the pink and black. Oh, it's gone in. Well, that's one less ball that you can play a snooker behind. So 26 behind now with every foul being worth 6. Matthew still needs 3 snookers. A pretty big ask when you've only got one ball on the table. But I think we're seeing Matthew try to slow Steve down and get him out of his rhythm. I tell you what, that was close. Bend the leg. Okay, so the first real chance for Steve to nail this down, and he takes full advantage of it. So Steve breaks away to a nice comfortable 4-0 lead as they head away for the interval. Probably delaying the inevitable a bit by Matthew, but like I said, I think he was just trying to stem the flow and make sure that Steve didn't have a clear head.
Let's talk about a more prosperous tomorrow. A tomorrow where your finances, property investments, property management, accounting, and financial planning are looked after in an exceptional capacity, all under the same roof. A tomorrow that works at your pace, where there's no overt pressure to make investment and financial decisions. A tomorrow where these processes are seamless, where someone is always there to support your financial and investment needs. At Reventon, our company's values are what ensure we remain distinctive to our customers. Integrity. Passion. Quality. Leadership. Customer experience.
So as we've established,
when hiring
Reventon,
you are hiring a team of professionals to support you in your investment and financial decisions. Whether you have been with us since 2005, or you're looking to purchase your first investment property, your future is Reventon's future. So, let's talk about a more prosperous tomorrow. Today.
You've got Reventon, as we've said. We've got the RACV Club, which is an absolutely beautiful venue. And there's much to see and do. Even if you want to pop out from the snooker and grab yourself a meal or a drink, and we can hear in the background that there is some sort of live entertainment. So yeah, pop on down to the RACV Club and get yourself a little bit of everything. As we see that Steve is just coming up to the table to watch Matthew kick off on the fifth frame. Probably didn't take as long as Adrian and Charlie, so they're both chomping at the bit to get back at it. Matthew trying to get his first taste of blood on the scoreboard while while Steve is just trying to remain focused and get that fifth frame. Meanwhile, Charlie Chafe, who beat Adrian in quite convincing fashion, is waiting to meet the winner of this match. I dare say if Matthew has his way that Charlie could be waiting for a very long time. Matthew just demonstrating his touch there, leaving Steve very tightly tucked behind the yellow. And he's going to want to play this in a way that Matthew can't get his first pot. Steve contemplating his shot here just to make sure that there's nothing left for Matthew when he gets to the table. Judging by Steve's actions there, it looks like he's very tightly tucked behind that yellow and can't see that much of the side cushion. Okay, so Steve's tucked in nicely on that red and hasn't given Matthew the avenue for anything there other than a safety shot, really. Awkward bridging, though. Hold on to your hats, boys. Yeah. Good morning. Okay, so should be interesting to see if he can get a little bit of rhythm going here. There's a couple of reds that are open so far. And now we see Mark Bullen making an entrance into the commentary box. One of the top players going around at Yarraville and had himself a fair event this week as well. So welcome to you, Mark.
Thanks, George.
So Steve's got the first bite of the cherry here. Not a lot of loose reds at the moment, but I'm sure Steve will peg away at them as he goes. He has opened up a red to the middle pocket, but he's still sticking with the one into the corner to stand onto the black. And if Steve can get his way into enough of those reds, it could be a good night to Matty. But as we saw with Charlie and Adrian, it doesn't take much to lose control. But again, he's played that well.
Yeah, I think you grow with a bit of confidence when you're 4-0 up, so Steve will take his chances here, I think.
Yeah, the cue definitely seems to flow a little bit better when you're only one frame away and your opponent's four frames away. And all you can do is sit and watch.
Steve's already on 38 and moving quite well. I just want him down the rail here.
Yeah, he's probably got enough loose reds now to put Matty in a bit of trouble by the time he runs out of them. Still looking very calm, very steady, very composed. But we've come to expect that from Steve over the years. Well into that one.
Yeah, he probably overcooked it a little bit, but he'll stand off for the blue here.
Yep.
Yeah, not sure.
Well, he looks like he's landed on the right side of the blue. I don't think he wants to dislodge too many reds though. Made the mistake of calling that too many times this morning.
Yeah, I think they must have about 48 or something on this break, so he's well and truly on his way to a 5-0 win here, and you know, with a couple of loose reds could put Matty in a lot of trouble.
Yeah.
Probably three loose ones there before he has to open up the last four. So
that's right, yeah.
Yeah, well and truly on his way, Steve.
Well, hopefully we haven't put the moz on and Steve continues on his merry way to see Charlie in the final.
Yeah, it would be a good final. Either way, I think it would be a good final. Charlie's hitting the ball very, very well. So,
Yeah, the match between Charlie and Adrian kicked off with Adrian just coming out with all guns blazing, and I know personally I just thought that Adrian was going to run away with it, but he just seemed to run out of steam very quickly after that. And Charlie just remained composed, and yeah, just, it was like a walk in the park. So very impressive performance by Charlie.
So yeah, Steve now 55 and sit nicely on the black with at least one loose red there, so I think this could be well and truly on the way to a 5-0 win for Steve. I don't think you'll do anything silly now.
Well, black and red is all he needs.
Much of an angle. Got on that nicely actually for the red in the centre. So just this red in the centre, and Matty will need snookers. Four reds left.
Well, if Steve gets the right angle on this black, he could be opening it up, but it looks like he's landed fairly straight. So
I'm not sure if that middle red there might go actually, but
no. Or maybe the plant's on. Like we've established, yeah, it's hard to tell from this angle, but Steve seems to be looking at it. And I think he'll be playing up towards Bork while he when he plays that as well. Yeah, he's missed it, but left very little for Matthew to come to.
A nice break there from Steve, though, 70 break.
Yeah, that's what you want, a nice little buffer, especially against Matthew. Ironically, back in Tassie when these two faced each other in the final, it was Matthew who knocked in a 70 in the final frame. But yep, 72 it was. Steve just had a lash at a shot to nothing. It almost came off. But again, Matthew comes to the table with very little there.
Yeah, and look, Matty can't really take a shot to nothing on a red because he needs big colours and doesn't want to be going back into Bork after potting a red. So, and on top of that, needs snookers. So, Matty.
He's played a very good shot there. He's only left Steve the red on the cushion. And as we saw last frame, any double kisses these guys are dealing with pretty harshly. So Steve doesn't want any double kisses on anything he plays here. Yeah, didn't really get quite as far up the table as what he wanted, so you might see Matthew pegging away at a couple of blacks here.
Yeah, look, definitely try and take a couple of high-value colours and, you know, keep one or two reds left on the table and try and get a free ball somewhere along the line, so if you can get two or three reds with high value colours, and I think that's what he'll do. He's tried to give that red a bit of a nudge, but maybe not. perfect on this red in the middle.
I thought he may have actually left that red to play the snooker behind after clearing up the other two reds, but
maybe he didn't want to take that red on the rail.
He might actually be planning on playing the snooker behind the black on these two reds. But it's definitely blacks all the way for Matty from here on in.
Yeah, I don't know if he's got into that enough, and I think he wanted to take that into the centre, but it's not going to happen now. You'll see a safety shot from here. Unless he's comfortable taking this on in the end pocket, yellow pocket.
Yeah, no real incentive too, but we'll see what he does from here.
Yes.
Is that a go? I don't think that's going to go, and it's rattled.
I think Steve will have a crack at this one. Just a little nick, and I think it'll be all over. Tough shot though.
Hopefully Neil Brown doesn't move from here. And I dare say that's it. And there you go. There's the second handshake of the semis, guys. And we now have a top draw final on our hands between Charlie Chafe and Steve Mifsud. So we'll be taking off for a bit of a hiatus. And apparently the final may be taking off at approximately 2:30, so log back in, guys, and get on the stream and share the link, and we'll confirm that a little bit later on. Okay, this is us signing off. See you later, mate.
Let's talk about a more prosperous tomorrow. A tomorrow where your finances, property investments, property management, accounting, and financial planning are looked after in an exceptional capacity, all under the same roof. A tomorrow that works at your pace, where there's no overt pressure to make investment and financial decisions. A tomorrow where these processes are seamless, where someone is always there to support your financial and investment needs. At Reventon, our company's values are what ensure we remain distinctive to our customers. Integrity, passion, quality, leadership, customer experience. When hiring Reventon, you are hiring a team of professionals to support you in your investment and financial decisions. Whether you have been with us since 2005, or you're looking to purchase your first investment property, your future is Reventon's future. So, let's talk about a more prosperous tomorrow. Today.